as actually comrades and friends, as Comrade Sharmista has said, our country is now confronting the biggest, one of the biggest challenges, that is, it is now led by the BJP regime, that is being led by RSS, the mightiest and the most long, the longest running fascist organization in the world today. So this is the biggest challenge that India is facing. And along with that, its agenda of a Hindu Rashtra is also moving towards corporatizing everything. It is for an unbridled corporatization of everything, as manifested in the latest farm laws, followed by the labor laws, followed, and it, in accordance with that, even all public sector undertakings are privatized, disinvested, and all democratic rights are being taken away. All these are there. So when we come to Kerala, the Kerala question is a unique one, as you know, comrades, because of its own history. For instance, Kerala is famous for a Kerala model, which you know. And the essence of this model is that in spite of a setback in economic field, in the with regard to the sphere of social welfare spheres, especially regarding mass education, regarding public health, regarding public distribution. So in the social welfare indicators, Kerala was comparable to advanced countries at, when during the 70s and the 80s. So it was based on that, in spite of economic deterioration, in spite of Kerala having no industrial or agricultural base in that sense of a developed society, if you characterize that development, the understanding on development, based on that, even though Kerala is not having that economic basis, its social indicators were at par with developed countries. So it was based on that understanding that the United Nations, based on a study in New York, carried out by the Center for Development Studies in Kerala and the United Nations together, led by the well-known economist Dr. K.N. Raj, came to what is called a new conceptualization, Kerala model. Now, what now Kerala is, and we know that this Kerala model has a history, it has a background, because Kerala is having one of the well-known, most important Renaissance movements, starting from the 19th century, an anti-caste movement, a movement led by the Communist Party from the very early times. And it was this progressive stream that made that enabled the Communist Party for the first time in history to come to power through ballot. That was in 1957 after the state formation, and that government brought about several progressive enactments. But what happened was that there was a liberation struggle led by the reactionary forces, the Syrian Christian, the Nayar forces, the all reactionary forces, financed and funded by CIA. All these are documented. The American-based CIA funded liberation struggle and led by the, and propped up by the then Congress government, and that ministry was overtoppled, was dismissed. And after that, what happened in Kerala was a reversal of this progressive stream that was earlier there. Now, along with that, of course, the land reform movements and all these were there. But we know that these land reform movements was only reformistic in character. The real tillers of the soil, mainly the Dalits and the real tillers of the soil, they were not given land rights. They were driven to colonies with no land. And in that, the Kerala model having these progressive aspects, some of these progressive aspects were there behind this Kerala model, but it camouflaged, it covered up the real life of the Dalits, the Adivasis, the fisher people. And so the marginalized and the oppressed people were not there in this so-called Kerala model. It was a middle class based Kerala model, which was financed by the Gulf money, mainly because of the mass exodus of the people to Gulf. And because 1/3 of Kerala's GDP, the so-called state domestic product, came from Gulf money. And it was based on that this Kerala model came to the forefront. And the 70s and 80s were famous for this Kerala model. And of course, the international context also, we know the welfare state was there. The Nehruvian model was there. State-led development was there. State intervention was there. It was a part of that Nehruvian model, the well-known welfare state propped up by international capital. Kerala was a showcase of that welfare model, this Kerala model. But as you know, by the 90s, when neoliberalism started, when imperialism, international capital abandoned the Kerala, this welfare state, in accordance with that, this so-called Kerala model was it also became unsustainable. So a new model in conformity with the neoliberalism was the requirement. So funding agencies, international agencies, together with the degenerated, because by that time the communist movement also had, we know, as happened elsewhere. In Kerala also, the mainstream left is mainly the CPIM. So they also had already degenerated to the ruling class positions. And because of their depoliticization, because of the de-ideologization, what happened was that the CPM was also became part of the ruling system. So using the CPM intellectuals and mainly using the main research center, that is Center for Development Studies in Kerala, an initiative for a new Kerala model, that is a neoliberal Kerala model effort was there. And the so-called People's Plan came into the forefront with the fund from foreign sources. All these are part of history. Now, what happens is that, I'm not going into that details. Now, along with the collapse of the Nehruvian state-led development in India, and along with the ascendance of this neoliberalism, what has happened in Kerala is also in conformity with that, the governments led by the CPM-led LDF, the Congress-led UDF. These are the two fronts. Every 5 years, this system will continue like that. That the 5 year the LDF rule, the next 5 year the UDF rule. So it carried forward like that. So this system continued, and every 5 year the same policies. The same after the 90s, starting from the late Nayanar government, especially after the Thiruvananthapuram in Trivandrum, a special conference of the CPM was held where they rectified the party program of 1964 regarding the approach to foreign capital. And there the approach to foreign capital was modified in accordance with the needs of neoliberalism. And from that, the CPM openly started propping up neoliberal policies without any qualm, like the UDF. Now, what has happened today? In 2016, I am coming to the present context. In 2016, when the Pinarayi government came to power with a massive majority because of the people's resentment against the then UDF government led by Umman Chandy because of its solar scam. So many scandals were there, and so many allegations of corruption were there. And because of these people's resentment, the Pinarayi government that came to power in 2016 got a thumping majority. But what happened was that by that time, the All India situation was a, we know, in 2014, Modi came to power. And Modi abandoned whatever left of the Nehruvian remnants. Modi abandoned the, we know, then Planning Commission. And instead, Modi created a Niti Aayog, a corporate bureaucratic think tank instead of the Planning Commission. And all, if the Congress government was actually disinvesting loss-making public sector units, Modi started disinvesting profit-making public sector units. So Modi brought the GST, demonetization. And so Modi started the unbridled, uncontrolled liberalization, privatization, far-right neoliberal policies. So it was in that context that the Pinarayi government came to power in 2016. So after coming to power, what the Pinarayi government did was he appointed, we know, you might have heard about that, he appointed the Harvard economist, Ida Gopinath, who is the chief economist of IMF now. So he appointed this Ida Gopinath as his chief economic advisor. This is a very startling move on the part of a so-called left-right government, because so many CPM intellectuals were there, who were even former, who were holding key positions in the government, even in the UPA government also, or in the CPM-led, erstwhile CPM-led governments in Kerala, even planning board vice chairman were there. But instead of them, Pinarayi appointed a neoliberal economist who later became the chief economist of IMF as his economic advisor. Then next, what he did, he appointed KPMG, a blacklisted international consulting company. As you know, these consulting companies, international companies, are known as masterminds of multinational tax avoidance. They are defined as masterminds of multinational tax avoidance, because these KPMG-like multinational consulting companies, KPMG, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Ernst & Young, Deloitte, these four multinational consulting companies, the big four, they are known as masterminds of multinational tax avoidance. They are now, with their auditing, they are now diverting. The corruption involved in it is more than $1 trillion per annum. These are estimated by international experts. So more than $1 trillion means, you can estimate, $1 trillion means 1 lakh crore. So that much corruption is there. So he, this so-called left front man Pinarayi, appointed KPMG as his economic consultant for taking up the ease of doing business, which is demanded by World Bank, to convert Kerala as an investor-friendly state. So to convert Kerala as an investor-friendly state, to make Kerala in conformity with the rules of business, in conformity with the demands of international capital, as laid down by World Bank, Pinarayi appointed KPMG to fulfill, to make Kerala as a state which is having these norms based on ease of doing business. That is the second thing what he did. The third thing what he did immediately after coming to power, that I am making these comments based on facts. What he did in June, he came to power by the end of May 2016. So in the month of June itself, the Pinarayi, the Politburo member of CPIM and the Chief Minister of Kerala, he removed one advocate. Her name is Sushila Pat. This advocate, she was as government pleader, she was earnestly fighting against the foreign corporate land mafia. Because Kerala is a tiny state, we know, only 1% of the land area. Kerala is having only 1% of the land area in India, while it is inhabited by 3.5%, almost 3.5% of Indian population. So the one can imagine the extent of the density of population in Kerala and the situation of land in Kerala. In spite of the land reforms, Kerala became the biggest, one of the state where which is having the biggest land inequality. Biggest Kerala is having the highest land in the in Indian society in India, come in spite of the land reform movement. So in that Kerala, these Harrisons, Kannan Devan, and similar other foreign companies, British companies, are holding almost 5.5 acres of land illegally without any document. And these Sushila Bhat was vigorously fighting these companies, and she was winning the cases in favor of the people and the government. So what Pinarayi did, he removed her from that post, and instead of that, he appointed a government leader who is an erstwhile employee of the same Harrison, who is holding more than 1 lakh acres illegally. So this is what he did. Then in 2017, what he did, the next year, Modi brought out the GST. And we know that Modi convened a parliament session, a midnight session of the Indian parliament in June 30, 2017. And the Indian parliament had a midnight session only in 1947, when power was transferred to the people, even though it was transferred to the ruling classes. So in 1947, there was a midnight session of the parliament for transferring power to the Indians. So similarly, Modi had a midnight session of the Indian parliament in 2017, and in that midnight session of Indian parliament, the GST was passed. GST is the biggest neoliberal tax reform after the Second World War, because by that tax reform, the resource mobilization right power of the states in India. India is a federal state. We know constitutionally the states have several rights. So these rights of the states, that is almost 60% of the resource mobilization rights of the states, were taken away by GST, by the Modi government, by a midnight session of the Indian parliament. Kerala, this is wonderful. In the Kerala government, led by its finance minister and the chief minister, with the finance minister Thomas Isaac and the chief minister Pinarayi Vijayan, they became the leading spokespersons, of this GST in India. And they supported wholeheartedly when even Tamil Nadu-like governments came against this GST, because it will be destroying the federal structure. Kerala came forward, the fascist Modi, but their claim was that Kerala will be gaining because it is a consumer state. And if GST is implemented, then Kerala's revenue will be increased by, it will be growing at the rate of 30%. That was the claim. What has happened? After the GST, Kerala's revenue growth actually crumbled to, it was plunged to just 10%. This is the situation, because we know what is the basic GST is okay, but what happens? The price in a country where the prices of commodities are determined by the corporates. So price determination power has already been transferred to the corporate companies. It is upon that this GST is imposed. Therefore, even though GST was imposed, the net tax gain to the government, Kerala government, was very little. So Kerala became one of the states, as of now, the per capita debt of the Kerala is 1 lakh, and that of Gujarat is only 50,000. That we must know. Gujarat is only 50,000, where Modi ruled for more than a decade, which is where Ambani had his growth, his wealth had grown by 13 times. That means 1,300% within 10 years. It is the Forbes magazine noted this is historic. So in that Gujarat, the per capita debt is only 50,000, while under Pinarayi government, the per capita debt is now almost 1 lakh. When Pinarayi government came to power in 2016, the total debt of Kerala was 1,50,000 crores. Now the total state debt, state public debt is now more than 3.25 lakh crores. When the after within these 2 months, when the Pinarayi government is completing its tenure, it is estimated that Kerala's debt will be more than 3.5 lakh crores. And when Pinarayi came to power, it was only 1,50,000 crores. That means over the 65 years, starting from 1956, over the 65 years, the total debt of Kerala, accumulated debt, was only 1,50,000. Under Pinarayi, within 5 years, Kerala's state debt rose to more than 3.5 lakh crores. That means more than doubled. This is the Kerala situation. Now, in this context, I am explaining this economic situation. So, Kerala is facing a very serious economic crisis. Environment, as Comrade K.N. in his presentation said, Kerala is facing one of the biggest environmental crises today. You all know the flood that happened in 2018. And now, when the economic crisis is intensifying, Pinarayi is now has formed a new neoliberal agencies, KIFBI. A very significant controversy is going on. And Pinarayi went to London stock market, London stock exchange. He inaugurated the London Stock Exchange in 2019, May 17. He inaugurated. And he rang the bell of starting the stock market. And he, using KIFBI, he had loans from international market, international bond market, at an interest rate of 9.72%. That also the highest in history. Because in the international bond market, when other countries are getting their loan, money through bonds at 2%, average interest rate in international bond market is 2%. For example, the Samurai bond of Japan, the Yankee bond of America, the Kung Fu bond of China, the Kangaroo bond of Australia. Such countries are getting money from international market at 2%. Pinarayi had his loan from international market at 9.72%. So Kerala is in a debt trap. And the whole economy and the comrades, I am not going into those details. The state government, the chief minister's office, is now controlled by consultancies and corporate big businesses. And so many cases are coming. Of course, the Modi government is involved. Modi government has its agenda. Modi government will be using all avenues through its agencies. This is a fact. But this government has never raised anything against the neoliberal corporatization policies of the Modi government. And the state government, as Deng Xiaoping has said, development is an absolute principle. What Deng said, development is an absolute principle. So Pinarayi is also saying that development is an absolute principle. It is against politics. It is against. It is above politics. It is above ideology. So development is there. No politics is there. No ideology is there. So development is ideology neutral. It is a depoliticized concept according to Pinarayi government. So those people who are displaced because of these PPP projects, national highway projects, these corporate projects. Now Pinarayi has said that they will be, those who are opposing these projects, they will be brought in the Gunda Act. Now Kerala has passed a Gunda Act to deal with these antisocial elements. So Pinarayi declared that those who are fighting his policies will be put in Gunda Act. So these neoliberal policies are going on in Kerala. And along with these neoliberal policies, now, as Comrade K.N. has presented, now the government, the Pinarayi government is propping up a type of Hindutva ideology like the Congress. Now, recently, Balasankar is the editor of RSS Mouthpiece Organizer. You know, RSS Mouthpiece Organizer, 11 years. Balasankar, an intellectual, he was the editor. And he had written a book. The name of book is Modi, the name of that, what is Creative Disruptor. The name of the book was Modi, Creative Disruptor, the Maker of New India. That is the name of the book written by this RSS man. He was the editor of, he organized for 11 years. Now he came out openly saying that there is a deal between RSS and the CPIM. This is, even Balasankar is still an RSS man. No action is taken against him. Now, when this disclosure came, certain debates were there, but that debate is there in the open society. So this is the situation. And he says that some 7 to 8 seats, there is a deal whereby the CPM RSS or CPM BJP deal is there. And the understanding is that both BJP and CPM want that the Congress should be eliminated from Kerala. Because Congress is a hindrance to Pinarayi, because the possibility today is for a UDF government. As of now, the BJP is not in a position to come to power in Kerala. Even though suffragization is intensifying, even though RSS is having its ideology, RSS is expanding its stranglehold over the Kerala society in manifold ways, in culture, in communalizing the people, in spreading Islamophobia, in through using certain this love jihad like slogans, which the court and investigating agencies said that no such a phenomenon is there. Love jihad means the Syrian Christian leadership said that the Syrian Christian girls are picked up by Muslim boys and taken away to Islamist countries for propagating IS ideology. So such a thing is not there. Even the Supreme Court has said that love jihad is a misnomer. But Pinarayi, the CPM leadership, the leaders of CPM, for getting the Syrian Christian votes, they are encouraging this. And the Syrian Christians who was leading the liberation struggle in 1959, I already said that the first communist ministry was thrown out by the liberation struggle led by the Syrian Christians, led by the Syrian Christians. Now the Pinarayi government is entered into a unholy alliance with the Syrian Christians against the Muslim community, like the RSS. So in that way, an underhand dealing is there between the RSS and the CPM, not only regarding the economic policies, and even at the level of the suffragization, this is there. I am not going to a detailed presentation. And even in the administrative level, in all aspects of administration, suffragization is going on. UAPA is selectively imposed on Muslim young, even DYFA students, because reading pamphlets is a cause for for this UAPA case being imposed on them. Similarly, eight persons were murdered through encounter by Pinarayi government. That too, after the martyrdom of Comrade Varghese in 1970, it is the Pinarayi government that started murdering those who are having these Maoist sections or whatever be. So this encounter does become a norm. UAPA is imposed and all these are going on. And even his police advisor, is not there, but his police advisor was a Raman Srivastava, who in 1991, when this Murali Manohar Joshi was leading in 1991, at that time a young Muslim girl, Sirajunisa, he was fired. He was called blood because this Raman Srivastava was the DIG. Then he demanded that I want the dead bodies of Muslim bastards. These are quotations. These are recorded. He said, I want the dead bodies of Muslim bastards. This man, after retirement, is appointed as the police advisor to Pinarayi. And the DGP of Pinarayi is Loganath Behara. He was involved in giving clean chit to Modi and Shah in the Isar Jagan case. These are the situation in Kerala. So I am summing up. Now the Pinarayi government, it is in the name of, it is keeping the what is called the cover of left, that is in under the camouflage of a left, it is cheating the people of Kerala. It has become outrightly neoliberal. And as Comrade Sharmista said, even Bengal, if the CPM is uniting with the Congress to defeat, to help the BJP, indicating the indirectly pointing out BJP as the principal enemy, indirectly pointing out BJP as the, sorry, Trinamool as the principal enemy, and indirectly helping in that way, helping BJP. Similarly, here in Kerala, in a different way, against Congress, that means putting Congress as the enemy, now it is paving the way for BJP. And this is the situation. So it is in this context. And the in all spheres, in democratic rights question, in environmental, in the caste question also, because of Kerala, this Pinarayi government is the first government in India to implement the economic reservation. Economic reservation, and it is challenging the BJP. The CPM secretary, Kodiyeri Balakrishnan, a Politburo member, he challenged the BJP leaders. Are you ready to implement? Are you ready to follow us as we are doing in Kerala? So the Pinarayi government implemented economic reservation in the for the first time in Kerala. So in all areas, its approach to the Dalits, its approach to the oppressed Muslims, it is towing the RSS line, and in neoliberal corporatization. So in all these fields, it is so in Kerala, the situation is that we know that it is the Congress that has led to that took up the initiative for bringing the BJP to power. The Manmohanomics actually led to Modinomics. So it was the Congress rule that started the neoliberal policies. So the UDF, the Congress-led UDF, has no different policies. And in spite of this serious situation, because there are enough policies to campaign against the Pinarayi government. But when the election campaign started in Kerala, the Congress leaders actually put forth a new position. They said that those who are coming to Shabarimala, 2 years rigorous imprisonment will be put on girls who are venturing into Shabarimala. This is the Congress position. So they are towing the Hindutva line, so they are competing with the CPM for saying that they are towing the Hindutva line. So the three fronts, the Congress led UDF, the CPM led LDF, as I have already said, and the fascist BJP. Even though the BJP is not in a position to coming to power in Kerala, so these three fronts are the main enemy, the enemies of people in Kerala. So in that context, we CPM and Red Star, we had a long discussion with the progressive forces, with the certain left forces, because the MCPIU, the CPIML cluster in Kerala, then the RMBI, and the one faction of CMB, Communist Marxist Party. So these four parties joining with the Western Ghats ecology movement, the Dalit movements, the other ecology movements, democratic rights movements, and housing rights movements. We took the initiative, and on March 6th, in the capital of Kerala, Trivandrum, we had a convention where a progressive political front is being formed, and this front is now in the contest of the election. We are just contesting only around 10 seats with our slogan for an alternative, a neoliberal alternative to neoliberalism, for a people's alternative. What should be a people's development? What should be the basic understanding of a people's development perspective of Kerala perspective? We are now contesting this election. At the same time, we know that, as Comrade Sharmisha has said, that election is only one part of the affair. So we are using this election as a launching pad for the coming people's struggles. So in this election, throughout Kerala, the PPF, Progressive Political Front, is having a campaign against these three fronts: the neoliberal corporatization, communalization policies pursued by anti-Dalit policies, anti-minority policies pursued by the ruling classes and their friends. And along with this campaign, we will contest the elections with a minimum program. A manifesto on the part of the PPF is there. It is published. And after the election, it is decided that whatever be the outcome, the neoliberal policies will continue, whichever front comes to power. So we will use the occasion for campaign. And after the elections, we will start the struggling process for a new Kerala, which is against the neoliberal model of Kerala that is now being built up by the present government. And this is what I have to say. And this is in conformity with our, in consonance with the All India position that is taken by CPML Red Star towards the these elections. And as we know, because Kerala is also having this election, everybody is concentrating on that election. Now, even today's Bent, because of elections, that Bent is not there in Kerala, but the we also joining with the other forces, our campaigns as part of our these against farm laws, and all are concentrating on the election now. And this is the situation in brief regarding Kerala, comrades. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade P. James. And like Comrade Sarmista, Comrade P. James also concluded with a warning that even if BJP is not coming to power in certain areas, or they may get a defeat in some states, the ideology of BJP, ideology of RSS, is gaining strength. The Manuvadi Hindutva ideology is gaining strength, and the fascization of the state is speed up. And so the real fascist danger is in front of us. So the question is, we will have to take up a very long-term struggle and wage a long-term struggle to defeat this ideology. And the struggle against which was actually delayed or not taken up by the traditional communist movement for long. Though RSS started with the Hindu Rashtra concept with the Manusmriti as its constitution in 1925. The record of history, we can see now the latest the writings of Bhagat Singh shows that how he was concerned about these things. And there were other nascent leaders also were concerned, but the communist movement could not take it up that way. And now, all after 97 years now, RSS has come to power through BJP, through Modi, and it is spreading its tentacles everywhere. And all the constitutional institutions and the state administration, military, police, judiciary, everything has come under its influence now. It has penetrated everywhere. And using the 7% of the upper caste people controlling already almost 75-80% of the bureaucracy, military leadership, and even 80 to 90% of the CEOs in the private sector, that way they have got a very big domination in all these sectors. Using all these things, now these Brahminical forces have come to power and they are increasing their posing a danger to our Indian polity. So people will have to become major struggle. In that context, CPML Rashtra has given the call for defeat BJP as a part of this struggle, long-term struggle, and utilizing election as a tactics to take this message to the people. And to our maximum capacity, we are taking up the question in the states where we are working. And now, before concluding, we will ask some questions may be there. And I request Comrade Kavi to say what are the questions. So that we can finish the question and session, and then we'll conclude the session. Thank you.
Comrade, there are some questions. I will segregate those questions. First,
yes.
There are some two general questions by Comrade Thomas from UK. First question, party position presented by Comrade KNR in the keynote speech is correct in the context of present BJP-led fascist rule, devastating the country and the oppressed masses. Is the progressive position based on anti-fascist perspective? that can defeat RSS, BJP, fascist forces as a central slogan in all five state assemblies. However, what is the progress so far achieved by revolutionary left in this perspective, including Rashtar so far in all these five states? Is there any remarkable achievement in uniting revolutionary and struggling left and other progressive democratic forces under this single agenda? That's the first question.
So is that addressed to general question?
Yeah, this is general.
I will send a short reply and then comrades can comment, say, add to it. Comrades, yes, as Commissioner Amista had concluded in the presentation, actually in West Bengal a situation had emerged when instead of taking BJP as the target and contributing to building the anti-fascist United Front at the All India level, when CPM took a dangerous position, which is helping the BJP to come nearer to power in West Bengal state also, there was a possibility that especially when liberation came out of the fold of CPM, there was a possibility that the ML forces or the forces who upheld the Naxalbari uprising could come together and start a alternative force in West Bengal, and it would have inspired the forces all over the country also. But what happened was not that. Actually, CP Liberation went on its own, declaring its own program, its own candidates, and it is not supporting the other revolutionary left organizations' candidates. For example, As far as our state committee is concerned, our state committee is fielding four candidates in West Bengal, and we have extended support to the liberation candidates and to other revolutionary left candidates also. But liberation is not doing that. Instead, they are supporting a large number of CPM candidates. So there are problems in this unity process. And today's Indian situation, there are two things we have to see. On the one hand, as far as the farmers' movement is concerned, contrary to the past, there is a good unity is emerging. And unity means at least united, all are united in supporting the farmers' movement. That is a positive thing. At the same time, as far as the building the revolutionary left alternative is concerned, though we have initiated that effort, it will take more time. So it is a very difficult task. It will take more time. We will not be moving away from that target. We will be working for achieving the target even after the elections. That is what I can say briefly. Commercial, you want to add something? PJ or commercial minister?
There is another general question, similar kind. The position taken by the revolutionary forces this time is novel from the parliamentary intervention, a novel form of the parliamentary intervention. After the practice of this approach, what is the impact we could generate in the ground level? Assam is to the poll now. How much we could consolidate the left forces and masses? Almost similar question.
The question is, we have to see. Comment in Assam, as I pointed out earlier, the PCC CPML state committee is contesting only two seats. And in all of the seats, they are supporting the candidates who can defeat BJP. So they are also upholding that no vote to BJP slogan. Same thing, liberation is part of the grand alliance led by Congress in Assam. But because they were not given the Karbi Angklong seat, they are putting a candidate there. But they are part of the ruling, it's Congress-led grand alliance. So they are part of that thing. They are not, historically, liberation had taken a position for the early 1980s itself. After the 13-party meeting in 1981, when it did not materialize, at that time itself, liberation had taken a position. We are not going for any unity of the Communist Revolutionary Forces. They shifted their position to go for an alliance with the CP and CPM, or even a merger with CP and CPM, as happened at that time in Nepal, where such three streams, CPI, CPM, liberation-like streams in Nepal joined together and formed CPN-UML, United Marxist Unionists. So the same thing they wanted to repeat in India also, but it did not materialize. But they are almost in that line, and their ideological positions are also nearer to CPM's position now. There is one problem. So they are part of that thing. And regarding other forces, we are regularly discussing with them. And in Bihar election, we are trying to bring few forces together, and we had intervened also against the BJP. Against BJP, we had raised the slogan, and we had campaigned also. So we shall continue this process, and we shall continue the struggle. And PCC, CPML, like organizations, are ideologically, politically very near to us. And we are, after the election, the discussions will be continuing. And we hope that these two tasks, building a broadest possible anti-fascist united front at the all-day level, and building a revolutionary left core, both these processes will be taken up more vigorously after these elections. Thank you.
Now, two questions regarding West Bengal. I will give both questions. First, Advocate Uttam Jagirdar, he asked, do we contest, it is already explained by Comrade Sharmista, but I repeat the question. Do we contest in West Bengal? How many places and where are they? Any united revolutionary front is formed now by the initiative of Rashtar in West Bengal? This one, question one. Can I give another question also?
Yes, please, comrade. Yes, please.
Yeah, another question by comrade Shashidharan, aligned in UAE. Red Star has most important and successful struggle in Bhanga, as reported by many times in Red Star Mandali, against Mamata-led TMC government. Many other instances can be shown the fascist nature of Mamata government to suppress the people in the state during last 5 years. Still, Red Star seems supporting TMC in the guise of opposing BJP. Is it correct Red Star accusing CPIM-led left front there for opposing both TMC and BJP together? Isn't it correct from the part of Rashtar and other ML parties to join left front to oppose both BJP and TMC in the present situation in West Bengal?
Okay. Thank you, comrade. So the first question first, as I have already said, Red Star is contesting 4 seats in West Bengal. And these are two in Bakura, Onda and Raipur, and in Bhangar in the South 24 Parganas, and in Gangarampur in South Dinajpur. So these are the 4 seats where we are contesting, and no, there has been no united front or united platform of the revolutionary forces directed towards contesting elections. But there is a general understanding. For instance, CPIML, whose organ is the class struggle, they have openly said that they'll be supporting us in Bhangar and in the other seats where we are contesting. So MKP, it is an understood fact that we'll be supporting them. They are contesting in Hingalganj in the Sundarbans, and it's an understood fact that we'll be supporting them in Hingalganj and they'll be supporting us in Bhangar. So these understandings are there, but apart from that, no platform as such has taken shape. This is the first. The second question is more important. Yes, the second question I'd like to explain in detail. Our position, let's go to West Bengal later. The position of our party at the All India level is that the BJP is the principal danger, and no other party in this country, no other party in this country can be said to be at a par with BJP or as dangerous as the BJP. We know what the Congress is, as Comrade James explained. We know that Manmohan Amukes, this led to the rise of Modi, Modinomics. And we know the contribution of the Congress for over 70 years to the shattering of the Indian economy and to paving a fertile ground for the rapid rise of fascism. We know the contribution of the Congress to this. But in spite of everything, the BJP is a party which is guided by a concrete fascist ideology, and no other party in this country can be said to be at a par with the BJP when it comes to the question of harming the country, harming the very basic framework of the country, destroying the very basic framework of the country. Now we come to West Bengal. In West Bengal, in consonance with this general position of our party, first, let me make it clear that we have nowhere given the slogan, vote for the Trinamool Congress. We have nowhere raised the slogan, victory to for the Trinamool Congress. Even the platform, even I'm coming to our party's activities later, even the platform Bengal Against Fascist Trinamool BJP, which is going by the slogan of no vote to BJP, even that platform in all its programs, in all its speeches, in all its literature, has categorically pointed out that the misrule of the Trinamool Congress over the last 10 years, the tyranny of the Trinamool Congress, the absolute lack of scruples, the rampant corruption, and a host of other things are all responsible for the rise of the BJP. However, at the same time, the left front cannot be exempt from the role, from its role in the rise of the BJP. If we go back to the 70s, we have Comrade Sundaraya's resignation letter from the party very clearly stated that the way the party was hobnobbing with the Jansang was boding ill for the future. From there, we have we go to the 80s, where in order to defeat the Congress, the CPM, we have this famous picture of Jyoti Basu holding hands with Vajpayee in the brigade. So they siding with the BJP to defeat the Congress. So even the left front cannot be said to be exempt from a role in the rise of the BJP. And as Comrade James explained, that even in Kerala now, the Islamophobia, which is actively preached and propagated by the Pinarayi Vijayan government, we saw it during the left front rule in West Bengal too. We saw how Buddhadev Bhattacharya, the chief minister of West Bengal, had said that the madrasas are the birthplaces of terrorists. And we saw the Sachar Committee report, how it exposed that in spite of so many years of left-front rule, the condition, the objective condition of the Muslims was deplorable in the state. So the left-front cannot be exempt from this. However, where the left-front, we now have a Facebook post of Suryakanta Mishra, who is the chief of the CPM in West Bengal, it has gone viral. And he has clearly shared a post where it says that in the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, people, their ranks had voted for the BJP because they had thought that the BJP would protect them from the atrocities of the Trinamool. But this time round, they were thinking of not voting for the BJP. Why? Not because of BJP's communal politics, not because of BJP's fascist politics, but because the old corrupt and terror leaders of the Trinamool Congress had joined the BJP. the ranks of the left front would not vote for the BJP this time. Why? Not because of the BJP's fascist ideology, but because the old leaders of the Trinamool had now gone over to the BJP. So it is very clear that the depth of the danger of fascism has not been explained to by the CPM to its ranks. And we know that in the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, how a major chunk of the left votes had swung over to the BJP, leading to its capture of so many Lok Sabha seats. So again, we are saying that it would have been the best. It would have been the best if a left alternative could have been created in West Bengal, which would challenge the tyranny of the Trinamool Congress and the communal fascist politics of the BJP. But what has the left front done? It has forged an alliance with the Congress. The Congress is any better than the Trinamool Congress? I mean, we have to believe the Congress, which is responsible for bringing in the entire globalization, liberalization, the privatization, this thing in West Bengal. This Congress is better than the Trinamool Congress. The Congress, which is notorious for its reign of terror in West Bengal, it is better than the Trinamool Congress. That we have to join hands with the Congress to defeat the Trinamool Congress. I mean, whom is the left front kidding? They are just desperate for power. They have been out of power in this state for 10 years, and being out of power does not suit them. They are desperate to return to power, and for that, they are willing to forge any number of unholy alliances, be it open alliances with the Congress or tacit understandings with the BJP. We know that there are tacit understandings with the BJP too. Why? Because the CPM wants to come back to power or closer to power. It wants to avenge itself on the Trinamool Congress for robbing it of its 34 years of rule. We know that this is what the CPM's most desperate desire. Finally, I'll conclude with, for instance, the example of Bhangar. So who fought against the tyranny of the Trinamool in Bhangar? It was the CPIML Red Star. It was the People's Committee over there. Yes, the CPM did support us, but the CPM was only in a very supportive role. Their leaders did not go to prison. Their leaders did not have the UAPA charged on them. Their general secretary was not kidnapped. Our general secretary was kidnapped. But yes, They were there, they were present in meetings, they spoke in favor of the movement at meetings and so on, and they did help us. In the panchayat elections, nowhere in Bhangar was the CPM able to field a single candidate. They simply fell to the tyranny of the Trinamool Congress. Red Star fought. It fought bitterly. The people of the villages, they escaped from the villages in the middle of the night. They crossed fields, they crossed ponds, and they came over to Calcutta. They hid in shelters, and then they went to the High Court and put their case before the judge. And finally, because of the High Court's intervention, we were able to contest, we were able to win. So with this legacy of fight in Bhangar, isn't it the principal duty? The principle, if the CPM had any principles, wouldn't it have been its duty to support the Red Star in Bhangar? To support the Red Star in the fight against the Trinamool, the BJP against all anti-people forces in Bhangar? It would have done that if it had a modicum of principle. If it had believed in a modicum of communist principle, struggling principle, it would have supported the Red Star in Bhangar. It had promised to do so during the 2019 elections when we had supported Bikash Ranjan Bhattacharya, the only person, the only contestant who did not lose his deposit. He was the all 42 candidates of CPM lost. Bikash Ranjan Bhattacharya also lost, but he was the only one who did not lose his deficit. So we had supported them in that seat, and they had promised us that they would support us in the Vidhan Sabha elections. They reneged on their promise. Even after we announced their candidate, what did they do? Even after we announced our candidate, what did they do? They teamed up with a Muslim leader who has no past history of struggle, who has no history of even standing by the struggle of the peasants, who has no history of anything whatsoever except for jalsas and Muslim religious gatherings, teamed up with him and forged a front which is as dubious as it gets, and this new party led by Abbas Siddiqui, ISF, it is now seen that ISF does not even have a symbol of its own. It is contesting on a symbol borrowed from the Rashtriya Secular Majlis Party, which is based in Bihar. Their symbol, which is the envelope, they have the ISF has borrowed that, and it is fighting on the symbol of that. So it is a very dicey thing. No one knows what Rashtriya Secular Majlis Party is or what its links to the ISF is. But the CPM thought it better to have an alliance with the ISF and support the ISF candidate or the Rashtriya Secular Majlis Party candidate in Bhangar, rather than support CPIML Red Star. It thought it better to bury the red flag. Yes, that is what they have done in Bhangar. Bhangar, which is the battleground of a glorious struggle against the Trinamool and the BJP. They have buried the red flag in Bhangar. CPIML Red Star is the only party which is upholding the red flag in Bhangar. So we have no faith in the CPM. We have no faith that the CPM will wage a struggle against fascism in any kind. However, we are still saying that in areas where they are in a position to defeat the Trinamool Congress, good for them, support them in such areas. But otherwise, our call to the people is no vote to the BJP. That is our call to the people. So how it translates to vote for the Trinamool Congress, we do not know. Our call is do not vote for the BJP. And in fields where the struggling left are fielding candidates, we are supporting the struggling left. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, comrade. Now there is two questions from on Tamil Nadu and Puducherry. The questioner's name written in Tamil, so I could not identify the name, but I will read out the question. What is our party's role in Tamil Nadu? And what is our work in Tamil Nadu presently? What is the strength and the general position of revolutionary left towards the present election in Tamil Nadu and Puducherry? Is there any remarkable united front by revolutionary forces formed by initiative of Red Star in these both states? Any candidates is fielded by party or united front supported by the party?
Kushal, can you hear? Okay, I shall say, then Kushal will follow.
Yes.
Actually, in the state committee, which I also participated based on this question, we have decided after a two-day discussion was there on the Tamil Nadu situation, on Pondicherry, Puducherry, Comrade Kushalar already said that our party has no organizational influence there, even though our position on Puducherry has already been laid out. In Tamil Nadu, we have our organizational presence in almost half of the districts. We have our presence, our contacts and presence, and in that, based on the present situation in Tamil Nadu, because the ADMK BJP alliance is now together, and if the ADMK wins, it is tantamount to, it is equal to a winning of BJP too. Therefore, even though the BJP alone is not in a position to come to power in Tamil Nadu, ADMK wins means it is a victory of the fascist forces, because ADMK is totally allying with the fascist forces. Therefore, defeat BJP ADMK alliance is the central slogan. And based on that slogan, today the other section is the DMK-led alliance. And in that alliance, CPIM, CPI and the Muslim League. This is the alliance, including other forces. So this is also a ruling front. But as Comrade Kane and Sharmisha has already said, our party's position is that in a fascist situation, fascism is a situation where the most reactionary, the most terrorist sections of the ruling classes are coming to power. Fascism is a situation where the most reactionary terrorist sections. So it is very important that they should be isolated. So all ruling classes are not fascist. Our party has no such position that Congress or ruling classes are fascist. Fascists are the BJP, RSS-led BJP, that is the fascist force, isolating the fascist force, defeating the fascist force, and defeating those who are allying with the fascists. This is the party's position. So based on that position, the Tamil Nadu committee evaluated the whole Tamil Nadu situation. Probably Kusheral will explain if he is connected. Then we got a detailed discussion there. And in that, we got a manifesto is drafted. And in a press conference that we had in Salem, on March 14, we had a press conference. In that press conference, we had a manifesto. And we had, before the press persons, we clearly said that this is our position, that defeat BJP, that is the slogan of the party, and uniting with us. So many forces are there. So many democratic forces and concerned citizens, intellectuals are there. And with that, we are taking this position. And therefore, that is in conformity with the position of the party. That therefore, this time, we think that they in Tamil Nadu, because we are not in a position to collect as much votes in any particular seat, so as to it will be helpful in such a way as to assert our independent position. So therefore, we are trying to assert our independent position through campaigns. Our slogans are there. Based on that slogans, we will campaign throughout the Tamil Nadu on this election, that defeat BJP. And naturally, after the election, we will carry forward the people's struggles and we will use parliamentary and non-parliamentary struggles based on our party position. Comrade Kushalar, better you explain the Congress situation there.
Your mic is muted. Your mic is muted, Comrade Kushalar.
Briefly explain, comrade, in a brief, in few words.
In comrade, shall I start, comrade?
Yes.
Comrade, in Tamil Nadu, these are the latest developments, there's so many, more than 20 organizations, left organization, ML forces, Dalit organization, and environmental organizations now. Coordination against defeat the BJP. So as our slogan. But we have to develop these the organization as not developed as a united front, not developed as a single coordination. We want to develop in future. At the same time, in the whole Tamil Nadu, is the mindset of the people is now they wants the is a new political change, that is already comrade BJ James told. So the ADMK comes to power means BJP comes to the power. So this is the situation in Tamil Nadu. So that is why Tamil Nadu party is not to field the candidate and raise the voice of the people's minds, defeat the BJP, defeat the ADMK. That is why we are going to make one this time not to field the candidate and made the political propaganda against BJP and ADMK.
Okay, comrade. Now on Kerala, there is a two question. The first question by same Shashidharan Alain, who asked the second question for Bengal. The first question from him. No vote to BJP, defeat BJP, RSS fascist rule slogan is correct in all India perspective and in the state where BJP has major strength. However, in Kerala, BJP is not a major forces and maximum possibility by any survey says only 2 seats there now. In India, Kerala may be counted as the single state where successfully resisted BJP so far, and the LDF government led by Pinarayi, Comrade Pinarayi Vijayan, is the main force main factor in for this resistance. In this context, Rashtar position targeting LDF and accusing LDF-RSS connection seems unrealistic. How Rashtar can justify this position in Kerala? This is the first question. Second question by Comrade Babu, TV Kozhikode. There is a Progressive People's Front, PPF, is formed, included by CPML Rashtar in Kerala recently. Some of the constituents, including RMP, has now openly supported UDF or become part of UDF in this election. The UDF has now openly propagating Hindutva ideology, including Shabarimala question, and helping BJP directly and indirectly for their growth. It is in this situation how Rashtar critically justify this position while propagating no vote to BJP. These are the two questions.
Okay, I shall briefly, because of time constraint, I shall briefly say, and if anything needed, our general secretary will conclude. Only two questions, comrades.
Yes, okay. One more general question that I will tell after.
Okay. Now, comrades, in my presentation, I said the extent to which, compared with any other period in Kerala history, the Pinarayi government, the manner in which Pinarayi government is helping the BJP regime in the economic field and in the ideological field. For example, today, because of the kid culture, we know that the Pinarayi government is spreading that it is now kid politics is now developing there. That they are, because we know that the welfare services is a natural, because earlier the erstwhile kings of Kerala, the Travancore kings, were famous for bestowing so many welfare measures to people. Now it is a natural duty of the ruling classes. That is why they are coming to power. They are using the taxes. They are using the taxes of the people. Now Pinarayi is spreading because in a neoliberal situation, even getting a few kilos of rice is something big for the poor people. That's okay. But when on the one hand Pinarayi is propagating, as I already said, is implementing the neoliberal corporate policies, and for that red carpet is laid down for Ambanis, Adanis, Indian corporates in Vizhinjam, in even in other areas, in insurance sector, in airports, even though apparently an opposition was built up indirectly helping Adani to take hold of the Trivandrum airport. There are evidences, because I am not going into those details. If time is there, we will discuss. So in all fields, not only Indian corporates, international companies are also now coming to Kerala because of the which I have in my presentation pointed out, because of its link with the international centers. And now, along with this neoliberalization and along with the propping up of this corporate land mafia, because there these illegally held lands in UDF, the present UDF election manifesto, interestingly, the Congress has included that if they come to power, they will take action, appropriate efforts to capture, to take hold of the illegal land held by land mafia. Because it is illegal, the Congress is compelled to put that position in their manifesto. But the Pinarayi government, the LDF government, has not taken that. The LDF government is hand in glove with, they are actually hobnobbing with, they are colluding with the illegal, the corporate land holders in Kerala who are foreign land mafia, and the Pinarayi government is joining with them against the people, against the Dalits, the Adivasis, our comrades who are in Tovarimala, in Wayanad district, our comrades who fought against the Harrisons illegally. There is no document. The Pinarayi police, they took our comrades and put them in jail for months. This is what the Pinarayi government is doing. So in that context, the Pinarayi is the number one agent of the corporate capital in Kerala. All media, the public relations department, you know, there is a concept PR. Concept PR is a public relations agency located in Maharashtra. Yogi Adityanath has employed that public relations agency, Concept PR, for doing public relations work during the Hathras event. Pinarayi has appointed the same Concept PR in Kerala. This is there. So there is no difference in these dealing with the corporates. And I have already said that, as Comrade Sharmishag has said, the CPM's approach, when Vajpayee was implementing, starting the GST, when Vajpayee laid down the foundation for what, up to 2005, and after that GST, Vajpayee contacted Jyothi Basu, and he got the help of the West Bengal Finance Minister Asim Das Gupta, who was an MIT retained. So it is in that way the CPM is connected with the international capital and neoliberalism today. So now Pinarayi is the chosen man, agent of this neoliberalism, and that is why the corporate media, the Godi media and international capital, all the media in Kerala is propping up Pinarayi. And the channel series is making pre-poll surveys. They are saying that the Pinarayi government is going to come to power. So an unholy nexus is working at the ideological political level. One point I said that because of these kit politics, that the kits are supplied, that is popped up as one of the important contributions of the government. Now Kerala is the state where a new phenomenon is developing. This V4, 2020, one pension. Now they are now corporate appendages, new post-political, post-ideological outfits are coming. Politics itself is corporatized because of this depoliticization that is going on. So these new developments in Kerala, depoliticization, de-ideologization, and up to 7 CPM leaders are now BJP candidates. Like in Bengal, it is started. Now all BJP CPM officers have become BJP officers. CPM leaders have gone to Bengal. Now in Kerala, under Pinarayi rule, it has started. The CPM leaders are now BJP candidates. This is fact. The comrade who asked the question can examine. So this is the situation. So this is not a sweeping statement. It is an objective fact that I have explained. The number one neoliberal corporate agent is the Pinarayi government. But it is always upholding the same, it has the same wavelength at political level. And Nitin Gadkari, the surface transport minister of Modi, he said, Pinarayi is the model of all India. That means Pinarayi is the model for all chief ministers. He is the only man who is efficient to implement the national highway project according to PPP model, public-private partnership model, entrusting the highway project to corporates. So Pinarayi should be taken as a model. This is what Nitin Gadkari has said. So that is why we have said it is obvious that it is neoliberal corporatization. And today, Islamophobia, CPM leaders are now saying that the UDF is led by Muslim League. CPM leaders are saying, now UDF is, Congress government, if comes to power, will be led by Muslim League. They are saying that Muslim League is Taliban. Now they are having alliance with the Muslim League in Tamil Nadu. Comrade Kushalar knows. They are having alliance with the Muslim League in Tamil Nadu. In Kerala, they are saying that Muslim League is Taliban. CPM leaders are saying, who are propping up Islamophobia? That is why we have said that. Now, second question regarding RMB. We have, against these three fronts. We have started a political, a core team is there, and a broad political, progressive political front is formed. And now, we are against these three fronts. Now RMB, for the last 12 years, RMB was formed because comrades know that the Chandrasekharan, TP Chandrasekharan, Comrade Chandrasekharan, who has come out of CPM, he was murdered. And the accused are CPM leaders who are in jail, everybody knows. Now from that time onward, the RMBI in Calicut, they are taking an anti-CPM position, and it is connected with their sustenance there. We know that they are sustaining there because of joining with these rightist forces. So it is joining with the rightist forces, UDF forces, that they are sustaining there from the very beginning. It is not a new thing. It is an old thing that is there for the 12 years. This is my understanding. Now, in other places, for example, in central Kerala, where CPML Red Star candidate is contesting from Pudukkad Trichur, RMBA leader T.L. Santosh has inaugurated this meeting, this election convention. So in that particular area, where this murder of Chandrasekhar, martyrdom of Chandrasekhar has taken place, there is a particular place where RMB from the very beginning is having this connection. So we are saying that you have to revise it, you have to examine it, and they are saying that this is a particular situation. So in course of time, what will happen? When the movement develops, when the PPF develops, it is quite natural that the RMB will have to take a position. The RMB will have to clear their position. Either they have to leave it, or within RMB, our understanding is that there is an idea. I am taking in the public sphere now. There is an ideological heated debate within them. It is going on, and we know the PPF constituents know all these things. We are discussing this, but RMB is always joining with us in fighting against this land question. Against the land question, where the so far the UDF, LDF, and the BJP front, they are having the same approach. And in Tovarimala, they cooperated with us. And in all environmental struggles, they are with us. So that is why we are uniting with them. And in course of time, naturally, this question will be taken up and it will be resolved. But for the time being, this relationship is there because of the extreme position that is prevailing there. This is the point that everybody knows it. This is not a secret. Okay, comrade.
Comrade, now one more general question. Comrade KNR can explain. From Comrade Raju Singh, was not the approach of CPIML towards a general election in the early days empirical? And also, is not the approach of the present day Maoist towards the election empirical? If so, then what would be the dialectical approach to view to the election? Comrade Ken, your mic is muted.
Comrade, please unmute yourself. Comrade,
your mic is muted.
Okay. That's okay. Comrade, because of the time factor, I have to be very short. This question is discussed in the among the Marxist Leninists for a long time. As far as the approach to waste parliamentary use of parliamentary struggle as part of class struggle, from the time of Lenin, a clear position was put forward, and based on the Bolsheviks' experience in the Duma, election for Duma. And then it was further explained in the left-wing communism and infantile disorder also, different approaches towards this question. And actually, in the Indian context, what happened in 1952, when the first general election was going to take place, actually there was a, without considering all these aspects, the party had taken a very basic deviation from using parliamentary struggle for developing class struggle to parliamentary. Jawaharlal Nehru was very clever when the Communist Party was and having restrictions over them because of the Calcutta thesis and many cases against the Communist leaders. And the Telangana struggle was still going forward, and the peasants were occupying the land and cultivating the land in Telangana, vast areas. So along with that, the Communists had secret factions in all the armed forces and Central Reserve Police, and using which the 1946 naval revolt could be organized and mobilized by the Communist Party. Knowing all these facts, Nehru government asked the communists, first, you withdraw the Telangana movement, and second, you dissolve all the factions in the armed forces. It is a very important question. It's a strategic question. And then the then leadership, in spite of the 1951 documents and the position, fairly correct positions put forward by the communists in the 1951 documents, they deviated, and a delegation was sent to Nehru government, and they signed an agreement dissolving these factions and withdrawing Telangana struggle. What happened because of this thing, we know. And thousands of women were working, were part of the Telangana struggle. And once the Telangana struggle was withdrawn, they asked the party leadership where we will go. Then the party leadership very shamelessly said, you can go back to your houses. They had to liberate, get liberation from the patriarchy and the enslavement in their houses. They had left their houses and joined the movement, and now the leadership was asking them to go back. That is the situation. So from that time onwards, there was parliamentarism dominating, and it went on increasing. And so Naxalbari uprising, we rejected it. But when we rejected it, we went to the other extreme. That is, we took participation of election as a boycott of election as a strategic part of the strategy. So all the forces, whether it is in CPML or outside CPML, everybody accepted the principle of as part of the strategy. Now, except the Maoists, CP Maoists, all other sections have more or less come to the understanding, whether it is small or big, all sections have come to understanding that we have to utilize the parliament election as part of the class struggle. And some people have gone more extreme to the rightist side also. But anyway, general understanding is that we have to use it as a part of the class struggle. And the CP Maoist is not accepting it, but at the same time, they are making, as we all know, opportunistic adjustments, supporting this party or that party, and as part of their anarchist line, they are taking many positions, and which is not contributing to the development of class struggle. And so as far as we are concerned, we have taken a consistent position now through our continuous discussions that elections should be utilized, parliamentary struggle should be utilized as a part of the class struggle. And with this perspective, we in the present situation, our political resolution adopted in the 11th Party Congress very clearly said the fascist forces are emerging in our country, and we have to use all forms of struggle to fight against the emerging fascist forces, including the parliamentary. And based on that line, when the five state assemblies elections were declared, we took the position. And we are taking a uniform position according to the concrete conditions in different states. We are taking a uniform position. And we found that PCC CPM also is taking a very similar position. That is why we invited them also to this webinar. So the question is, ask comrades, the comrade who asked the question can well understand. The question is, there is a lot of variation, differences. A lot of differences are there among the different organizations in this approach. And some people are contesting the election only for a namesake. Some are still, though they accepted participation of election as a tactics, they are not contesting. All these questions are there. So only through a process of unity, that discussions and merger and the unity in going forward to a powerful, building of a powerful Marxist party, these problems can be solved. So it is a long struggle. We have to understand it as a long struggle. And now, as far as we are concerned, we are very clear on this question. And to this clarity, we have to bring others also, like in other question, other ideological questions also. Okay, go on. And now, this is our question. So I will say a few sentences in concluding this. One question we have to understand, this one question, one comrade from Kerala had asked a question about the Pinarayi government and other things. One question we should understand clearly is what is explained very well explained by a commercial minister in the context of Bengal developments. Actually, in Tripura, we are not discussing Tripura. CPM is not in Tripura. What happened in Tripura? There was no TMC. In last election in Tripura, from CPM to BJP, how this transformation took place? 25 years continuous rule of CPM was taking place in Tripura. After 25 years of continuous rule by a comrade, Manik Sarkar, whose simple life and everything was well accompanied with everybody. And what happened? Even CPM leaders all over the country were saying, what a simple life and other things. Yes, I know him. And he's leading a very simple life. We appreciate such comrades also. But that alone is not sufficient. After 25 years of CPM-led left-front rule in Tripura, what happened? RSS led BJP. That is, BJP leader came to power there. They got a very big majority there last election. How can they explain this? There's no TMC or anybody in between. From CPM rule to RSS rule. How it happened? Because in Tripura, like in other areas, there were no ideological struggle, no theoretical struggle against Manuvadi Hindutva, Brahminical concepts. And which even Bhagat Singh called for. Bhagat Singh in his young age called for in 1929-30 period. That article we have published now, this time Rashtar also. How he has called for, without fighting caste system, without fighting this religious fundamentalism. And for that, he wrote an article that I am a Nastic, I am an atheist. So he wrote that article. That means clarity was there with Bhagat Singh. But what clarity was there in the communist movement? Did communist movement never fight against RSS ideology of Hindu Rashtra? Britishers used this Hindu Rashtra ideology to support the other people, other sections, Pakistan demand all, and then divided the country. What was the position of the communist movement in India? The communist movement in India, instead of taking a secular position, a Marxist Leninist position on towards religion, what they did against the writings of Lenin and Stalin on nationality question, they included religion also as a category to decide the nationality. No, history cannot, these things are not discussed in the communist movement properly, left movement properly. History cannot pardon such things. Before the 47, the ideological role played by the communist movement in leading to the division of the country cannot be denied by anybody, because we could not take a secular position and we did not follow the Lenin's and Stalin's understanding about nationality question, and we added the category of religion also into nationality. So and we never fought against RSS ideology. And that is why CP could form governments with Janasangh in 67. And the 89 elections, they could stand together. And so many things happened. So now what has happened in Tripura, after 25 years of continuous rule by BJP, CPM, the RSS was building up. RSS was building up in Tripura. And they took over. And the same thing happened in Bengal in a different way. And that Samista has explained. And in Kerala, comrade who raised the question should know, and he should read what is happening in Kannur district, where the CPM is the strongest. The CPM party committees are observing Bala Gokul, and they are giving new names, and they are organizing Ramayana Mass, month of Ramayana reading. And now they have started observing Ganapati festivals. Ganapati festivals are never in Kerala. Now some RSS people brought this to Kerala, and now CPM party committees are observing Ganapati festivals. That means RSS is working through that way. RSS was working and he is working by penetrating the ideology into every sector. They are penetrating, and that is why Bhagavat said, we are not interested in BJP. We can work through any party. They have worked through Congress. In 1984 elections, they supported the Congress, and Congress got the largest majority. And what Rajiv Gandhi government did, they got everything, appointing a governor. But this is the name I forgot. That governor who actually created the Pandit problem, everything in Jammu Kashmir, and created conditions for the worsening of the situation there. And it was at that time the Babri Masjid was opened for Shilanyas. At that time, so many things were done by Rajiv Gandhi government. And Rajiv Gandhi government started election campaign in 1989 from Ayodhya with Ramarajya propaganda. All these things are part of to understand how the CPM is now playing in the hands of RSS, or they never dared to denounce RSS as a fascist organization, like Prakash Karat articles very clearly says. And Prakash Karat article is still the dominant document in CPM. That is why in the last party congress of CPM also, they never said that RSS is a fascist force, and the coming to power of Modi is bringing fascist danger or increasing the fascist danger. They did not write in the document, because according to CPM, it is not, RSS is not fascist, Modi government is not fascist. You can see the latest, before concluding, I will say the one sentence more, that is in the People's Democracy has written an editorial, and that editorial, when they say about the fascist TMC, there is no quotation. It is fascist TMC. But when they write about fascistic action of RSS, that fascistic is in quotation. That means they don't accept RSS as fascist, but they accept TMC as fascist. This is the ideological position of CPM. So we can see how dangerous that degeneration has taken place, and how they are paving the way, like what happened in Tripura. Now it is happening in Kerala, West Bengal, and it will happen in Kerala also. RSS is taking over everything from inside. They are penetrating and Hinduizing and communalizing everything. And that thing we should understand, it is happening around us in Kerala and around us all over the country. So fascism has to be fought not only on this this thing. What is seen outside, what is ideological base of the fascism? Without fighting ideological fascism, the ideological basis of fascism, we will not be able to defeat it. So we have to make it an all-embracing struggle against fascism. That is a danger today, and that is a principal task. And that is why we say we have to work broadest possible anti-fascist United Front should be built up. We should work for it. At the same time, the revolutionary left polarization also we have to work for. So these two tasks we have to take up, complementary to each other. And this discussion will, we shall continue the discussion. And on the eve of polling tomorrow, people are going to vote in West Bengal and Assam. We hope our slogan, our campaign had its impact, and BJP will be defeated in all the five states where the election is taking place. Thank you very much. Thank you all the comrades who participate in the discussion. And thank all the viewers and all those who send the questions. And we shall continue the discussion, and we shall continue the struggle against fascism with all our might. Ratsalu, comrades.
Okay, comrades.